I met him 2 years back when we featured him in our 35 under 35 special. At that time, the business had just started, and now, I mean, in 5 years of operation, we see the company almost at the stage of a unicorn. So a big clap for Abhiraj Bhal. And Abhiraj, thank you so much for taking our time.
My pleasure. Thank you so much for having me. It's an absolute honor. And as I mentioned, I have a very special place for entrepreneur in my heart, so I can never say no to you guys. So thanks a lot for having me.
Thank you. So Abhiraj, as we all know, every fancy startup story starts at an IIT. And you also went to IIT Kanpur, and that's where we, the entire thing started. So at that time, were you thinking about starting as an entrepreneur? Was there at the back of your mind?
No, I don't think so. I think in IIT, you're barely looking to get through the courses without failing and somehow graduate with some respect. And you know, you're surrounded by such immensely smart and intelligent people. So I was, throughout my school, I was a topper. And then I found myself in IIT Kanpur. And I was, I guess, for the longest time, struggling to even be class average. And that was a very humbling experience. In fact, I'm pretty sure a lot of my batchmates look at me and say, you know, if he can do it, then so can we. You know, so I graduated bang in the middle of the class average, and I also graduated in the recession of 2008-2009, which was perhaps after the 1929 Great Depression, one of the worst financial crises that the world had seen. So we were, you know, to be honest, just worried about how we can find a job, because it was a tough market to graduate in. And also, it wasn't like I was a 9-pointer or a 10-pointer. I was in the middle of the class. So I never thought of entrepreneurship or any such thing. I said, as long as I can graduate with some respect and a job, that's good enough.
Okay. So you also went to BCG, this interesting combination. Interesting mix that brings out the entrepreneurship in you.
So BCG I went to after I graduated from IIM Ahmedabad, where I did my MBA. You know, BCG was a great time for me. I spent 3 years across India and Singapore as a young 24-year-old management consulting has the opportunity to put you into boardrooms and expose you to CXOs and CEOs. So it's a phenomenal, I would say, learning ground for understanding how business is done. But at the same time, somewhere, you know, I felt that it would be great if I could be in the thick of things, right? It's almost, you know, as a consultant, you often feel like the guy who's standing at the edge of the ring in a boxing match. And as much as you stand at the edge of the ring in a boxing match, unless you jump into the ring and take a few punches, you can't learn how to box. So that analogy, I think, is true for business as well. You can consult all you want from the sidelines, but unless you jump in and try to build something of your own, you will never have that real experience of, you know, what it takes to build a business, all the difficult sleepless nights that one has to go through, and the fighting in the trenches. And many people in the audience who are, you know, entrepreneurs have built their own business can relate to it. It is not all, you know, hunky dory. It's tough times. It's times when you have to battle it out. And I think somewhere I knew, even at BCG, that was the kind of experience that I wanted. So I had a lot of fun at BCG. But 2-3 years later, I realized that it was time to move on.
Great analogy. And I mean, after that, you also started another venture before. Yes, you succeeded with UrbanClap. Would you like to talk about your previous endeavors or some failures as an entrepreneur? I started another venture. I mean, that's for Cinema Box.
Yeah, so actually, very few people know that before UrbanClap, we had one company called Cinema Box, which failed. And by God, did it fail badly. You know, when I started Cinema, I won't even get into the details of the idea, but in one line, if I was to tell you what we were trying to do, at Cinema Box, we were trying to install a box in a bus, train or plane which would stream movies and other content onto your smartphones. So the idea is best described as on-demand entertainment in long-haul travel. And I remember coming up with this line, and at the time I felt like this was a huge, huge opportunity and the next big thing and so on and so forth. So Varun and I, you know, my co-founder Varun and I, we started this company after leaving BCG. I think we started this company with a lot of naivety. Everything that BCG had taught us, market study, you know, deeply doing research, we did none of that. We kept it all on the side. We said, now we are entrepreneurs, we'll go with our gut, we'll go with what we feel is right. And this idea was like a light bulb moment that came to us, and we said, this is it, this is what we are going to build. Long story short, it took us a few months and, you know, a lot of money, personal money that went wasted, to realize that this business was never going to be a viable, large business that we had imagined that we would build. And it wasn't going to be the next big thing. It wasn't going to be deeply impactful for society at large. It wasn't going to earn us a lot of money. It was basically a bad business. And that was a very hard pill to swallow, because, you know, you have all these fancy degrees and you have all this international experience in management consulting. You actually tend to believe that you have the right to succeed. And then when you're not seeing that success, it's a little bit, it's difficult. It's not very straightforward. Also, I think at the time we were meeting a lot of entrepreneurs who were similar to us, you know, IITs, IIMs, and, you know, but who were also unsuccessful. Some of you are meeting only unsuccessful entrepreneurs in that phase. That's the other thing, when you're an unsuccessful entrepreneur, you only meet successful ones don't meet you. So when we were meeting these unsuccessful entrepreneurs who had spent 4 or 5 years building their companies, and it was very clear to us that they're going nowhere, we realized that, well, success is not a given. You know, I mean, we are looking at these people and we said, hey, if we continue with Cinema Box, it's quite possible that 4 years later we are in their place. You know, no business, nothing real, and, you know, still at it. So I think that kind of scared us. And then a very, I would say, strong dose of objectivity prevailed, where we had the ability to look at our own business, which we were so passionate about, with dispassion. And that, I think, is very important, because often we get wedded with the ideas that we are executing on or the businesses that we are building, and we lose objectivity. And I think that objectivity was not just relevant for Cinema Box, it has actually kept us in good stead even at UrbanClap, because we've made multiple business model and operating model changes. So one day Varun and I got together, you know, and a good thing with building a business with your college friend is you can get together over a bottle of old monk and just call it quits. So that night I remember, you know, we said, this is not working, the writing is on the wall, we can spend 2 more years and then call it quits, or we can call it quits today. And that night we basically shut the business, and the next morning when we woke up, I think, you know, maybe it was youth, right? And one of the most amazing things about youth is that you feel that you're bulletproof, right? So that feeling of bulletproof was there. We felt completely unfazed. We didn't care about the fact that we had lost a few lakhs, or that time had gone, or the first attempt was a failure. We felt supremely bulletproof, and we felt that, great, acha hua, it got done. Now at least we can focus on the next thing, which might be successful. And then we started to think about what we can do, and that's how that we got to UrbanClap.
Idea came in for
UrbanClap. So this time we were, you know, more careful, I think. Once bitten, twice shy. So we did a very classical market study and went and spoke to a lot of customers, a lot of service professionals. I wouldn't even say that, you know, UrbanClap, it's not even an idea, right? In some sense, we are organizing an unorganized sector. So it's more of a sector which is unorganized, which has always remained for, you know, decades and decades. Home services and local services has always been around, but it has been an unorganized sector. And I think after shutting Cinema Box, when, you know, that by that time Raghav had joined us, who's our third co-founder, and he had shut his own company. So the three of us had one thing in common, that each of us had crashed and burned one company, which is great. Then we started on this journey of UrbanClap. We were okay to take a little bit more time, we were okay to spend more time in the field talking to customers, talking to service professionals, and really trying to understand what the pain point was in, you know, the home and local services market, and how can we attack that pain point. So I don't think there was a light bulb moment this time. It was more of a methodical, you know, spending time in the field, talking to customers and service professionals, and then trying to arrive at a meaningful solution.
Hyperlocal is not an easy segment to crack, and we have seen other concepts losing money by people and also shutting down. So, what worked in your case, and how did you achieve those $100 million in 5 years?
So, I would say one of the things that has worked in our favor is that we have, throughout our journey, you know, we started in November 2014. So it's been almost 5 years for us now, you know, a few months less than 5 years. And throughout our journey, we have been very focused on creating good customer experience and good experience for our service professionals. And I'll take a minute to talk about each of these. See, on the consumer side, what do customers want? They want a high quality service, they want it on time, and they want it at the right price. These were the three biggest pain points in our sector. You call a service professional, they don't show up on time. They will come and they will do a half-baked job of the service. And then they will quote you whatever price they feel. If you are wearing a Rolex watch and you are in a great house, the price will go up 2x. Early on, we recognized these three core problems, which is quality is broken. Therefore, invest in training. Train your service professional. Don't shy away from setting up training centers. Today we have more than 15 training centers in the country. We have more than 100 full-time trainers. And we have just, day before yesterday, signed a long-ranging MOU with the Ministry of Skill Development, which focuses on setting up 250 training centers with more than 5,000 trainers who will train 10 lakh service professionals over the next 5 years. So, we've been very clear that yes, we are an app-based company, yes, we have a technology presence, but at the end of the day, the problem is in the real world. And so you cannot shy away from that problem. If there is a dearth of quality and skilled professionals, you have to do training, and you have to invest in training. That became the first step. Similarly, on the service professional side, if I was to talk about what their biggest pain point in life is, if you see today, the average plumber or the average carpenter or the average beautician who is living in the offline world and working in the offline world is making 10, 12, 15,000 rupees a month. I remember I grew up in Bombay in the 90s. Being a beautician was a very respectable profession. My father was in the Navy, the Indian Navy. And you had officers, you know, wives of naval officers who would take course of beauty for a few months and then set up a small beauty parlor in their house, and it was a very respectable profession, and they were back then making 10,000, 12,000, 15,000 rupees a month in the mid-90s and the late-90s. Fast forward to 20 years later, the beautician is still making 10,000 and 12,000 and 15,000 rupees a month, right? Cost of real estate has gone up, cost of marketing has gone up, cost of products have gone up. Consumers are not paying more money. So what ends up happening is, the one line item in your P&L for the salon, which is the salary of the beautician, is constantly cut. And what happens in 10,000 or 12,000 or 15,000 rupees a month today, right? If you're living in Delhi or Bombay, you cannot even afford, you can't even send your kids to good schools. So this was a rampant problem in the local services space. They were good professionals, but they did not have access to the market. They were underutilized. Middlemen were eating into margins. And their earnings were 10, 12, maximum 15, 18,000. In our model, we said that the professional will become a micro-entrepreneur. So he or she will work for himself or herself. For every 100 rupees that the customer pays, 80 will go into their pockets. And the more jobs that they do, the more money that they can make. Actually, if you do the math, and if I just take the example of beauty, you know, on an average, consumers spend 1,000 or 1,500 rupees. So if 80% goes into the pocket of the beautician, and she is even able to serve 2 or 3 customers a day, which is quite possible to do. She can make 2 or 3 thousand rupees a day, or 60 to 90 thousand a month. So the potential is massive if the model is tweaked. And today, on the UrbanClap platform, we do have that. We do have many, many, many beauticians who make upwards of 70, 80, 90,000 rupees a month. Last week I was having breakfast with an AC technician whose kids study in DPS Archipuram. The other day, a friend of mine called me and she said, you know, I booked a beautician from UrbanClap and she's asking me where she can park her car. And what do I tell her? I said, tell her where she can park her car. I mean, these professionals deserve respect. They deserve the right to have a meaningful middle class wage. And these are skilled professions. So we need to start looking at them differently. And what UrbanClap has done for them is not just improve their earnings to 30, 40, 50,000 rupees or even more. It's also given them the respect, the legitimacy, all of those nice things. Today they have a bank account, they have a credit card, they have insurance. They have a certain legitimacy to what they do. And that I think has been a big impact for us on the service partner side. And as a result of this sort of win-win model for consumers and service partners, the company is scaling fast.
As an entrepreneur, you are creating these micro-entrepreneurs. So, but when you are building a tech business, of course, you are looking at valuation, you are looking at raising funds because the business costs you a lot of amount and you need to pay customers, you need to market your business and everything. So how as an entrepreneur you keep a track on equity dilution?
So first of all, I think you know, you used a word called sumicon when you started and then you said unicorn, and I think these are honestly the most, you know, pardon my French, but these are the most bullshit words and metrics that are doing the rounds today. I think, and let me tell you why I say that, and let me qualify that. When you are a publicly listed and a publicly traded company, you have a certain valuation. The valuation in the public markets is a consensus amongst a wide range of people that this is what the company is worth. If some people believe it's worth lesser, they will start selling and someone else will start buying. And a very, very efficient marketplace exists of buyers and sellers which are agreeing that this is what the company is worth. In the private markets, you need to convince one human being to give you a certain valuation and then that's what you're worth. Now, obviously, we all know that it's far more difficult to convince a large spectrum of people compared to one human being. And therefore, I think as an ecosystem, while it's good to celebrate milestones, whether somebody reaches 100 million in valuation or half a billion or a billion, beyond that one day, you know, as entrepreneurs, you need to forget about it and you need to move on. And you also need to be cognizant that someday you have to take this company public. So you have to defend this valuation in the real world. And the real world doesn't care about your technology or how fancy your app is and stuff like that. They care about cash flows. And they will value your company on free cash flows. They may give you some time to grow, and if you're especially a fast growing company, they may understand that you have some losses, etc., etc. But eventually your company will be valued on free cash flows. So we've been very cognizant of that from day one. Not to say that we don't invest in growth and we don't burn money. We are a loss-making company today. We are likely to be a loss-making company in the future. But that's also because we are growing at 200% year-on-year. If I had to focus on growing at 40 or 50%, which is a very healthy growth rate in my opinion, I could turn profitable today. So a lot of the growth, a lot of the losses are focused on investing in future growth and maintaining a high growth trajectory. At the same time, it's a tight rope. You have to be very, very careful and cognizant of how you are spending. You have to be very careful and cognizant of whether you are overspending or whether you are right spending, and whether you are investing or whether you are burning. There is a thin line between investing capital for growth versus burning money. And that, I think every entrepreneur makes that trade-off and makes that fine balance. It's extremely, extremely important not to get carried away with valuations, with funding. In fact, in some sense, we should be celebrating it. And you know, one of my angel investors wrote this recently. He said, it's important to celebrate periods in a company's journey when they are not raising capital. Because that means that they don't need more capital and they are actually self-sufficient. So self-sufficiency needs to be celebrated.
Initially, for how much time you remained bootstrapped, and when was the time you said that, okay, now I should look for outside funding?
So we were bootstrapped for, I think, typically lesser time than most companies are bootstrapped for. We were bootstrapped for about a year or so. I think most organizations will, or most entrepreneurs will be bootstrapped for 1.5, 2, maybe even longer number of years before they raise capital. In our case, we knew that it was a competitive market and that there were lots and lots and lots of competitors who were jumping in, and therefore it was important to raise outside funding and institutional funding earlier rather than later, because at some level capital is an advantage if you have it with you. So about a year into our journey, we had raised our first institutional round of capital.
A lot of people in the audience might be interested in knowing from you, okay, when is the right time to reach out to investors, and apart from money, what is the value they bring on? Would you like to share some nuggets of wisdom on that side?
My advice, and this may not, you know, be completely accurate, or you have to take it with a pinch of salt. My own opinion is that one should not reach out to investors and wait for investors to reach out to you. And I'll tell you why and what I mean. See, everybody wants to look at something that they can't have. It's the simple nature of human behavior. When you approach an investor, the typical view is he's desperate for capital. That's why he's writing to me or she's writing to me. Versus if they feel that a company is unapproachable. So, you know, I can tell you, when we had raised $0 in capital and investors would write to me, and usually the young guys, the analysts and the associates, partners will not write to a company that has raised $0. So the analysts and the associates will write to you. My typical reply to them would be, we are not looking at raising capital right now. Let's talk later. And suddenly that would, you know, I knew that in the internal methodology and the way they work, it's required that they escalate, because they would feel, what kind of a company is this which doesn't want to talk to us, you know, and we are XYZ high quality investors. Why is this company not interested in talking to us? And then they would come and talk to you. So my sense is, number one, don't reach out to investors. Build something meaningful, they will reach out to you. Don't worry about that. They will definitely reach out to you. That is their job. Also, don't get carried away if an investor has called you for a meeting. Don't get excited about it. That's his job. His job is to meet companies. So he's doing his job. Wait till you have a term sheet. In fact, wait till the capital actually gets into your bank to be convinced that you actually have capital. So that's on the first. And what was your second question regarding this? I totally forgot. What value they bring to the table? Money. That's 95% of the value they bring to the table. A lot of them bring a lot of other values, and they can be amazing thought partners, amazing strategic partners. But one should not expect that. You should go in with the view that the investor brings money to the table. Anything else that comes is bonus. And as far as money is concerned, make sure that it's a good, respectable, reputable investor. After that, all dollars are green or all rupees are of the same color, so it's fine. Doesn't matter. You can take it from anybody as long as they're respectable and reputable. That money is not, you know, being earned the wrong way. As long as it's been earned the right way, capital is the most important thing. Beyond that, an investor will add some strategic value, some thought partnership, but don't expect that from an investor.
So recently, UrbanClap has also gone global with Dubai, right? And so what are your plans to further expand your global move, and what has been the learning from the global markets for
you as a startup? Yes, so we've expanded to Dubai and Abu Dhabi. Dubai we expanded last year, Abu Dhabi we expanded this year. We are likely going to launch Singapore as well in the later half of this year. I think our learning has been that the problems that people face, mostly in many parts of the world, are similar. So everybody all over the world is looking for home services. Everybody all over the world is looking for high quality home services at the right price and on time. Those three principles that I spoke about is not just relevant in India, it's also relevant in Dubai, and we feel it's relevant in Singapore as well. Now, as long as one is aligned on those principles, it's worthwhile to go and enter these markets and try to build a business. Keeping those principles very, very clear cut. You cannot directly export your Indian model to these countries. You have to localize and you have to tweak the model for the local market. So you have to be open to tweaking your model, but you should not tweak the principles with which you're building it.
Why Dubai as the first market for you?
Why Dubai? I mean, you know, I'm actually a believer of taking bets which are incremental in nature and not very massive bets which may actually, you know, where you in some sense are betting the ship, as they say. So Dubai for us was, you know, a nearby geography, large Indian diaspora. If we can't win in Dubai, it's unlikely that we'll win in London. So that was my thought process, that let's first capture the low-hanging fruits, establish ourselves, you know, improve our product, improve our service, become a stronger company before we venture out into larger, more global markets.
You spoke about being a loss-making enterprise. You spoke about how you can become profitable. And with this, I mean, what are your thoughts on building a tech enterprise to an IPO level? Would you ever want to achieve that?
Absolutely. I think once you have taken institutional capital, you have to return it back. And you have to hopefully return a lot more back than you've taken. Now, there are only two ways to return capital back. Either you go public or you sell your company. We don't want to sell our company. So going public is a stated objective of our company. And we believe that we should be well set up to go public over the next 3 to 4 years. So it's not a long-term objective that we are chasing, it's a relatively medium-term objective. I think when we go public, it is important that we are a profitable entity, because public market investors, as I rightly said, are scrutinizing every company from a very, very dispassionate lens. So no amount of storytelling works with them. They care about your balance sheet, your income statement, and your cash flows, and they will value your company accordingly. So I think we will look to turn, therefore, profitable over the next 2 to 3 years before we move on.
Thank you for your time.